The Crisis of the Middle Class Constitution is Ganesh Sitaraman's second book, after the Counterinsurgent's Constitution, Law in the Age of Small Wars. And this book is both a history of the idea of income inequality in constitutional republics. Spoiler, ours is the first constitution that doesn't assume the idea of class divisions. And an argument that we now need to adapt our constitution to work against the class inequality that we see all over our country. We all know how important this is. It's in fact so important that Senator Elizabeth Warren has said that every American needs to read this book. So you guys are doing great. Right. Ganesh Sitaraman is an associate professor of law at Vanderbilt and a senior fellow at the Center for American Progress. He was policy director to Elizabeth Warren during her successful Senate campaign and was then her senior counsel in the United States Senate. His writing has appeared in the New York Times, the Boston Globe, Politico, and more. We are very glad to have him at Politics and Prose, so please join me to welcome him to our stage.
Thank you. I'd like to thank C-SPAN for covering this event, and thank all of you for coming today. We do still have some empty seats, both on this side here and right up in the front, so if people want to come on down, there's lots and lots of space. Come on, don't be shy. Don't be shy. We're going to be shy. Okay. Well, I expect some of you were a little skeptical maybe about coming to this talk, a book called The Crisis of the Middle Class Constitution. After all, what more could possibly be said about economic inequality and the crisis of the middle class? And then you get here and you see me and you're probably wondering what could be said by someone who looks like he's 12 years old about this topic. Well, I'm going to try to take on this huge task. You might even call it a huge task. And it's a hard task. And the reason why it's so hard is because we know a lot about it. Everyone here lived through the election of 2016. And we know that there were a lot of people who were really upset in the last year about economic inequality. Both Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump relied on economically populist rhetoric and got a lot of support for it. We've all seen data on rising economic inequality over the last 30 years. We've all seen data on the shrinking middle class and the insecurities of the middle class over the last generation as well. But I'm not an economist, and so I want to ask a different question. Is economic inequality, is the collapse of the middle class, a constitutional problem? Now, you might be skeptical of that suggestion, too. After all, the Constitution doesn't say anything about the middle class in it. It also doesn't say anything about economic equality or inequality in it explicitly. If anything, these days, the Constitution seems like it gets in the way of combating economic inequality. Take just the Citizens United decision, which enables wealthy people and corporations to disproportionately influence public policy. But I think the shrinking middle class and economic inequality are a constitutional problem, and I'm going to try to explain to you why in this talk. For most of the history of Western political and constitutional thought, from the ancient Greeks to the 18th century, constitutional theorists and statesmen were very worried about the problem of inequality, economic inequality. They worried that if a society was deeply divided into rich and poor, the rich would oppress the poor, or the poor would try to confiscate the wealth of the rich. And the result would be strife, violence, and revolution. Now, the founders of this country knew that history. They were steeped in history. And they were well aware that economic inequality was a serious source of instability. They knew that if the wealthy took power, they would slowly start to tilt the laws so that outcomes would favor them. As John Taylor of Caroline said in 1814, when the rich plunder the poor, it is slow and legal. The people, increasingly angry at rising economic and political inequality, would respond, but not through some sort of mass uprising. They would look for a leader to help them overthrow the oligarchy. A future Broadway sensation, Alexander Hamilton, you may have heard of him, he did not give up his shot. He said in the very first of the Federalist Papers, "Of those men who have overturned the liberties of republics, the greatest number have begun their career by paying an obsequious court to the people, commencing demagogues and ending tyrants." Oligarchy, tyranny. The citizens of unequal republics confront a dire fate. So statesmen and thinkers had two solutions to this problem. The first was to incorporate economic class right into the structure of government. In ancient Rome, for example, there was a patrician senate for the wealthy, and then there was the tribune of the plebs for the poor. In England, you have the House of Lords for the wealthy. You have the House of Commons for the poor. I call these class warfare constitutions because they build class conflict right into the structure of government. Each class has a share in governing and also a check on the other, and this is what creates stability. The second solution was first articulated by Aristotle, who said that the best government was a government in which the middle class was bigger than the rich and the poor, and in which, therefore, the middle class would govern. He called this a middle constitution. I call it a middle class constitution, hence the title of the book. Now, this solution is something of a cheat. The idea that you don't have that many poor people, you don't have that many rich people, you have a huge middle class, just says there isn't really that much economic inequality, so you're not going to have conflict between the rich and the poor. As a result, though, it means you don't need a tribune of the plebs. You don't need a patrician senate. You don't need this checking system that existed in the class warfare constitutions. Now, the founding generation understood this history, and they believed that America was unique in the history of the world because the distribution of wealth here was relatively equal. Now, I know that seems crazy to us, but put yourself back in the 18th century. What you have is a sparsely populated country, mostly along the eastern seaboard, some towns, lots of agriculture. But the center of the world is Western Europe to the people in the American colonies. It's London, it's Paris. And so when the people here look across the ocean, across the Atlantic, what they see are big differences. There's no feudalism in America, unlike in Europe. There's no hereditary aristocracy, unlike in Europe. Even the richest people here, the George Washingtons, and I'm sure many of you have been to Mount Vernon, it's right down the road, a beautiful home, but nothing compared to the palaces of the dukes and duchesses in England. Doesn't compare. America had another thing too. It had vast lands to the west. And what that meant was that any white man, and it was limited to white men at the time, could become a property owner and have a measure of economic independence. So let me just read you a couple of brief accounts that indicate some of this. The first is from Noah Webster, who you've probably heard of, the creator of our dictionary, Webster's Dictionary. And he said that an equality of property is the very soul of a republic. While this continues, the people will inevitably possess both power and freedom. When this is lost, power departs, liberty expires, and a commonwealth will inevitably assume some other form. The second is Charles Pinckney. Charles Pinckney was a delegate to the Constitutional Convention, and here's what he said at the convention in the summer of 1787. He said, America was not only very different from the inhabitants of any state we are acquainted with in the modern world, but also distinct from either the people of Greece or Rome, or of any state we are acquainted with among the ancients. Pinckney believed America, quote, had a greater equality than is to be found among the people of any other country, and he thought that equality would continue because, quote, the nation possessed immense tracts of uncultivated lands, which would ensure there would be few poor and few dependent. So what you see here is a belief that, first, economic equality was necessary to have a republic, and second, that Americans were relatively economically equal, so that a republic would be possible. There's actually good reason to think that they might have been right about this, too, that it wasn't just a belief that they had. Two economic historians, Peter Lindert and Jeff Williamson, have done extensive work on economic inequality in the founding period, and what they've found is that in 1774, on the edge of the American Revolution, the top 1% in America took home 8.5% of national income. Now, that's about the same as it was in 1976. In comparison, today, the top 1% take home more than 20% of national income. A huge difference. Williamson and Linder conclude that in the late 18th century, America had the most egalitarian distribution of wealth of any country they could calculate in the world. So with relative equality as the backdrop, when the founding generation adopted our Constitution, they didn't make it a class warfare constitution. There's no tribune of the plebs in our system of government. There's no property requirements for becoming a senator. The framers knew how to write these kinds of provisions. They actually debated things like this in the Constitutional Convention and in their state constitutions, but they ultimately rejected them for our federal constitution. And this is a radical change. This is what is deeply radical about our Constitution. It is not a class warfare Constitution. What we have is a middle class Constitution. It's a Constitution that's based on the assumption that America had and would continue to have relative economic equality. Now, over the course of the 19th century, the economy fundamentally changed. Industrialization, urbanization, the closing of the frontier, the shift from artisanal work and agriculture to wage work in factories, these developments all put pressure on the economic foundations of our constitutional system. During the Gilded Age, economic inequality was on the rise. Economic power was increasingly concentrated in a small number of robber barons and plutocrats, and people at the time were very worried that this was a threat to the Republic, a threat to our constitutional system. As Theodore Roosevelt said, there can be no real political democracy unless there is something approaching an economic democracy. I'm going to read you a passage from the book here to give you a feel for the concern of how the wealthy would corrupt the political system, turning our government away from a republic. And this is from the 1880s and 1890s. Marcus Daly was determined to stop William Andrews Clark. Clark, like Daly, was an industrial magnate who owned copper mines, mills, smelters, lumber, banks, retail stores, newspapers, and utilities. But what Clark really wanted was to win elected office in Montana. Partly, he wanted the status and power that came with public leadership. Partly, he wanted to support policies that would improve his business holdings and harm those of Daly. When Clark stood for Congress in 1888, Daly men pasted their handpicked candidate's name over Clark's on ballots, leading to Clark's loss in an instance of spectacular fraud. So began Montana's War of the Copper Kings. Over the next two decades, copper magnates in Montana would engage in some of the most blatant, surprising, and shocking efforts at corruption to gain political power in American history. Daly canceled business contracts with those who would not support his political aims. He started his own newspaper to compete with Clark's. The two fought over whether the state capital would be located at Anaconda, Daly's company town, or Helena, which Clark supported to block Daly. And they gave away cigars, brought rounds of drinks, and sometimes just handed out money in an effort to garner support for one city or the other. Clark decided in 1899 that 1899 was his last best chance to get into the Senate, and he was willing to pay legislators whatever it cost. The opening bid for a bribe was $10,000 a vote, with many reportedly coming in at $20,000 and one rumor of $50,000 for a vote. Clark's son remarked that they would send the old man to the Senate or to the poorhouse. For his part, Clark said that he had never bought a man who wasn't for sale. By some estimates, Clark spent $431,000 to buy 47 votes in the state legislature and offered more than $200,000 that was rebuffed. Commenting on the brazen corruption in the election, Mark Twain said of Clark, "He is said to have bought legislatures and judges as other men buy food and raiment. By his example, he has so excused and so sweetened corruption that in Montana it no longer has an offensive smell." Senator William Clark took office in Washington, only to have investigations open immediately. After hearing testimony from state legislators and even Montana Supreme Court justices whom Clark's agents attempted to bribe, the Senate Investigations Committee declared Clark's election void. In an amazing maneuver, Clark resigned, and his allies in Montana contrived to get the governor out of the state, making the lieutenant governor, a Clark ally, the acting governor, at which point the lieutenant governor appointed Clark to fill the now vacant Senate seat that Clark had just been denied. This was the kind of corruption that was going on in the Gilded Age. Money buying Senate seats, buying politics, shaping political outcomes. And the populists and progressives were deeply worried that this was going to ruin our constitutional system. It would be the end of the republic. And so they came up with some of the most creative solutions to this. On the economic side, they invented antitrust laws to break up consolidations of corporate power. They passed a constitutional amendment to create an income tax. In order to prevent economic power from unduly influencing politics, they passed the first real campaign finance reforms. And they even passed a constitutional amendment for the direct election of U.S. senators. Now, these battles continued through the Progressive Era and even into the New Deal. But after World War II, the idea that economic inequality was a threat to our republic largely disappeared from our national consciousness. I think this happened for a few reasons. The first is that the New Dealers largely won the battle over whether the federal government was constitutionally able to act in the national economy. Fights over economic policy as a result shifted from being a constitutional debate to being just a debate about regulation and policy. The second change was the Cold War. From the founding through the 19th century and even into the early 20th century, people who came to America, the founders and the waves of immigrants afterwards, left aristocracies and monarchies to come to a republic. They knew very well that there was a difference between living in a republic and living in an aristocracy. That was real to them. After World War II, the contrast shifts, and now the question is capitalism versus communism. And in that contrast, fears of communism cut against discussions of equality, even in the American tradition. The third is that we entered a period of prosperity that economists call the Great Compression. GDP was up, median incomes were up, America's middle class grew larger and larger. As a country, we undertook policies that helped make this happen. We regulated finance, Securities and Exchange Commission, Glass-Steagall. We imposed taxes at pretty high rates in this period. And we also invested in our own people to try to get them into the middle class. We sent a generation to college through the GI Bill. We encouraged home ownership. We invested in infrastructure like highways, which both created jobs and growth. And we put into place programs that would help lift up the poor, Medicare, Medicaid, Head Start. In this era, economic inequality simply became less of an issue. Now, I know some of you have been probably thinking from the very start, you've been objecting, but what about women? What about African Americans? How can the story I'm telling possibly coexist with the reality of deep inequality between these groups and across these groups? So in the book, I distinguish between two traditions. The first is the one I've been talking to you about so far. It's the tradition of the middle class constitution. And the idea here is that for there to be a republic, you have to have relative economic equality within the political community. But this leaves open a very important question. Who's in the political community? And that's a question that has been fiercely contested, including violently contested, in our history. But over time, we can also trace a tradition, which we can call the tradition of inclusion, which has expanded the political community in this country to include women and minorities. I think the key thing to think about is what happens when these two traditions intersect. When you expand the political community, it now becomes necessary for all new members of the political community to also be able to join the middle class, or else the republic can't succeed. And throughout our history, statesmen understood this. After the Civil War, for example, the Reconstruction Republicans fought not just for emancipation and political rights, but also for 40 acres and a mule, for a measure of economic independence. And I'll just read you a brief bit from Thaddeus Stevens. Thaddeus Stevens was a Pennsylvania congressman, one of the leaders of the Reconstruction Republicans. And he had proposed a bill confiscating the estates of the top 10% of rebel planters and redistributing that to the freed slaves of the South. Here's what he said about his proposal. He said, "Without this, this government can never be, as it has never been, a true republic. Heretofore, it had more the features of aristocracy than of democracy. The southern states have been despotisms, not governments of the people. It is impossible that any practical equality of rights can exist where a few thousand men monopolize the whole landed property. The larger the number of small proprietors, the more safe and stable the government." After his death, one of his colleagues said of his views, "He knew that a landed aristocracy and a landless class are alike dangerous in a republic, and by a single act of justice, he would abolish both." So the aim of the Reconstruction Republicans was to link these two traditions together, inclusivity, but also the middle class and economic equality. We also forget that this was a key part of the civil rights movement in the 60s. The March on Washington, where Martin Luther King gave his I Have a Dream speech, was the march for jobs and freedom, economics and politics. And what I think is important about this today is we have to understand that as we've expanded the political community, we have to make sure that everyone has a part and a chance to join the middle class. And this is a challenge because we're once again in an era of increasing economic inequality. And that's why this is a constitutional problem. It's a constitutional problem because our Constitution wasn't designed for a society of inequality. It was designed for a society of relative equality. Now, looking at the long history of republics, I think we have a couple of options for how we can deal with this going forward. The first is that we can try to realign this mismatch of economic equality and our constitutional structure just by abandoning economic equality. We could say we want to be an unequal society, and we could embrace the class warfare approach. We give up on being a middle-class nation. What would that mean? What that would mean is we would probably have to change our constitutional structure at a root level. We might need one house for the rich and one for the poor. We might have to resurrect the Tribune of the Plebs from Rome. In fact, there's a professor at the University of Chicago who thinks we should do just that, that we need a new Tribune of the Plebs. But I think these are pretty outlandish ideas and probably unlikely to be implemented, and probably even undesirable. I don't think we want to be a country that has fixed economic classes. The second option is that we have to rebuild our middle class. We have to reshape our economy, and we have to make our politics more democratic. Now, there's a lot of things we could talk about here. We could talk about raising the minimum wage, organizing workers through unions and political movements. We can talk about political reforms from voting to campaign finance. But the bottom line is we have to do these things not for economic reasons, not just because they're important little tweaks to our system. We have to do these things because what's at risk is the very core of our constitutional system, the very core of what it means to have a republic. And here's the thing. The founders would have understood this. They knew they were building a constitution on top of a set of economic assumptions, and they knew that someday conditions would change. I'll just end you with a quote from the father of the Constitution, James Madison, who thought quite a bit about this problem over the course of his life. And in 1829, he sat down to compare the availability of land, the ability to move west, with the estimates for population growth. And he thought that it would be 100 years before America really had to confront the problem of inequality. And here's what he said. He said that when that happened, quote, "the institutions and laws of the country must be adapted, and it will require for the task all the wisdom of the wisest patriots." I think what we need today are wise patriots who can help reform our system so that we can preserve our republic. Thank you. So I'm happy to answer some questions from anyone who's interested. We have a mic right up here in the front. So feel free to come on up, get in line. Questions, I'll just point out, often have a question mark at the end. So if you have questions, that'd be terrific.
So this isn't...
Can you just say your name for us all here?
Yeah.
Our names are great.
Caroline Poplin.
Hi, Caroline.
This isn't exactly what you were talking about, but it'll give a time for other people to think of questions. I always thought the middle class was sort of a modern thing. It wasn't in ancient times. Ancient times was like the Odyssey. You know, you had aristocrats, and then you had peasants or serfs or whatever, slaves. That we didn't get a middle class until we had industry and that sort of thing. So how did Aristotle come up with this middle idea?
So it's a great question. And part of the question is, what do we mean by middle class? And this is a hard question for anybody using the phrase or even writing about it, because a lot of the time when people say the middle class, what they want is, give me a number, give me a fixed dollar amount. Well, that's a hard thing, because in every society, in every country, even in the same society and same country across time, that completely changes. Inflation, prices, there's lots of changes. So dollar amounts, these kinds of things are very difficult. I define middle class in the book as just saying not the very rich, not the very poor. And in fact, that's pretty consistent throughout history. And you see people talking about this in these terms. For Aristotle, it's pretty simple to see there can be a rich, there can be a poor. And he says there could also be people in the middle. The thing that Aristotle says when he says, how come, he doesn't talk much actually in the politics about these middle constitutions. And the reason why he says is, well, this would be the best kind of constitution, a middle constitution. But when we look around, we just don't have any societies that are mostly middle-class people. Here, it's all rich and poor. So for him, it was very theoretical. If we move through history, you still see people talking about a rich, a poor, and they recognize that there is a middle. But the middle emerges at different times and in different places. In Florence, there's a writer named Donato Giannotti, who I write about in the book, who identifies a change that happened in Florentine politics leading to the rise of what he calls the mediocre. I don't know Italian, so I'm probably mangling that. But it means the middle, the people in the middle, the mediocre, the in-between rich and in-between poor. And so there's a sense of that, too. James Harrington in England in the 17th century recognized that there are these peoples in the middle. In the 18th century, you see lots of people in early America. They don't use the phrase middle class, but what they say is the middling people, the middling sort, and somewhere in between the wealthy and the poor.
Mm-hmm.
The middle class itself really does take prominence, as you suggested, in the Victorian era as a phrase. But I think the basic idea of it is actually pretty consistent throughout the political thought of the centuries before that.
Interesting. Thank you.
Yeah, let me thank you for a very interesting talk. I have a few questions. I must say first, I'm from the Caribbean, so I'm from a little different part of the world, and I studied law in the Netherlands, so I come from it from a different angle, too. And I was somewhat surprised that you declared, obviously, the American Constitution to be a kind of a middle-class constitution, right? I'm sure you know the writings of Beard, the great political writer who pointed out how the Constitution was written in the United States, right? Mostly by wealthy people to protect wealthy interests. Granted, there was a lot of land and there was opportunities for certain people to get in. But the issue is, it was written basically to protect certain interests. And the issue becomes, aren't those interests really now coming home, to use Malcolm X, the chicken's coming home to roost to a certain extent, right? So that would be the first question. The second question would be that, obviously, you retort to me and let me do that for myself, right? Could be, well, just a minute here, right? But you had to a certain extent, certainly between, as you pointed out, right, this great income equalization, between brackets, obviously, between 1945 and 1980, right? In Europe, I grew up in Europe. I remember one day walking from my university at Utrecht home, and there was something, I was maybe 18, 19, and I'm thinking there's something wrong in the society. Something is coming apart. And it's snowing, and bus drivers passing, telling me to get in the bus, I'm gonna freeze. I'm like, leave me alone. I'm thinking, don't bother me. And it came to me, what had happened? That basically, what you had in these societies, in Western societies, right, was the largest solidarity mechanism starting to fracture and break apart, right? The kids of the working class now were moving up. They were becoming educated. And they didn't have much relationships as their fathers had with the working class anymore. So they didn't feel this need for a social welfare state or anything. That was a botherance to them, right? So the issue is, obviously, for this thing to work, all of the institutions have to work in a certain way at a certain time together. Once you get the Supreme Court packed by fundamentally right-wing people, you get a political system packed by increasingly right-wing people who don't really reflect. We know Hillary Clinton won by 3 million votes, right? Basically, the guy lose the election. He's still president, right? So the system itself is a huge problem. So the issue is, and the issues that you put forward also seem to me to demand, right? You didn't touch on them, to demand a much more radical redistribution. A much more radical redistribution of wealth, income, and power, right? A much more economic democracy. So how do you think about these issues, and do you see any move anywhere? Because this is not only the United States. Look, I'm so-called French Dutch. France, Marine Le Pen could be president. Dutch in Holland, Geert Wilders just win significant amount of votes. So how do you see this playing out? And do you have a lot of optimism how this is going to play out? Thank you.
Thanks. Great questions. On the first question, a little bit of background. About a century ago, there was a historian named Charles Beard, and he wrote a book called The Economic Interpretation of the Constitution, a very famous book. And in the book, he argued that the Constitution was designed by the founders basically to rig the system to serve their own personal economic interests. And he went through in great detail showing the different interests of all the particular people at the Constitutional Convention and so on, trying to link that up to outcomes of the Constitution. This thesis, which really sticks with us, I think, a lot of people in the historical imagination, was actually decisively debunked by historians in the 1950s, who went back through all the evidence and showed that Beard was wrong. And so on the specific claim that the Constitution was rigged by the founders to serve their own personal interests, there isn't much to that. But the broader claim is still a very powerful one, that the Constitution was rigged by people to try to establish a more aristocratic form of government. But I think the challenge that we have to ask ourselves if we think about the Constitution that way is, why didn't they rig it more? And just think about that, though. The whole history of governments before that included things like property qualifications for members of upper houses, like the Senate, even for the House of Representatives, potentially. You could imagine designing a system that way. The 1780 Constitution of Massachusetts, the longest standing constitution in the history of the world, written by John Adams, had property qualifications in it for the governor, for the senators. It was deeply aristocratic. These kind of designs were debated widely throughout the colonies in the time and rejected. That is a radical change. And the reason that they were rejected, there's a number of reasons. Some are practical. How exactly would you design these things and so on? And they debated those things. But one of the things that you see consistently in the reports in the notes from the Constitutional Convention is them referring to the people who were absent at the Constitutional Convention, and that's the people. And they knew what the people wanted, and they knew what the people believed, which was that this was actually an equal society, and they couldn't rig the system more without running afoul of what the people would accept and what the people really wanted. And so the founding generation, the people who ratified the Constitution when they were embracing it, were not embracing a document that they thought was rigged for the system. You don't see people who are Federalists making the argument, this is a great constitution because it entrenches the elite and will overthrow all the power of the people. That's not what they say. What they say is, this is a great constitution because every aspect of it draws, some directly, some indirectly, from the great fountain of the people, the great part of the democracy. Everything is rooted in that. And so there was a sense at this time that that was a real constraint, a real a thing that people believed. And so that's why they didn't rig it more. So I think that's the way we need to think about it. The baseline isn't how we think about democracy today. The baseline for them is looking at 2,000 years of history and looking at the European experience. And on that grounds, I think it's a quite radical document. To your second question, how should we think about the changes we need today? There are a lot of things, like I said, and we could go into these. I'm sure being in Washington, there's many policy experts in each of these areas. But you know, we talk a lot about things like the minimum wage, which is a way to lift wages up. We talk about redistributive mechanisms, taxes, transfer programs. But there's also front-end things you can do, what one scholar has called pre-distribution, thinking about how the economy runs so that it generates more equal distribution of wealth. Antitrust for the progressives, as I suggest in the book, was one of the ways they thought about this. And the idea here is that if you have a nation of small business owners, small proprietors, what you have is not a massive concentration of wealth in the few. You have it being distributed across everyone. And so antitrust was partly about that. And what's very interesting is when you go back and look at whether it's Louis Brandeis, Roosevelt or others, when they talk about antitrust, they often talk about it in constitutional terms, that it is essential to break up consolidations of power to preserve our republic, to preserve our constitutional system.
Hi, good evening. Adam Aviles. Thanks so much for your talk. And as you were speaking, I found myself sort of thinking throughout, you know, what happens if we take this interpretation and sort of flip it on its head? So I've heard the argument advanced that a certain amount of inequality is good in a society. Particularly, you see that in the argument that, well, it's an incentive and it's an economic driver. Having the opportunity to move from one class to another, you know, motivates people to work. And in fact, having another class is what provides that incentive. I'm curious how you would approach that if, you know, perhaps the other alternative interpretation would be not that equality was presupposed in the framing of the Constitution, but rather that inequality was presupposed and was accepted to be a good thing, or that a certain amount. Now, where that amount of what's good and what's too much, of course, is a large field for debate. But, you know, similarly, I've, you know, I recall being in elementary school and have been taught time and time again how our own legislature mirrors that of the Roman Republic's upper house, lower house, and so on, as opposed to being different. In fact, is modeled on that very same thought process, which involves an upper and a lower class. So I'm just kind of curious, you know, what your thought process is in terms of what happens when we take that argument and kind of just look at the, sort of like flip the concavity of it, look at the mirror image, and start thinking in terms of, you know, what inequality's role is.
Great, thanks for the question. You know, to start with the second part of it, thinking about the Roman case, I'll just stress again that the key difference actually between our system and the prior systems is that it doesn't build in class directly into the structure of government. And this is a hard thing to tell in some cases, because we think of the Senate maybe as the Roman Senate or as the House of Lords, and we think of the House of Commons as the House of Representatives. But there was a big difference in how people thought of these over time. And the shift, the radical thing that James Madison explains in the Federalist Papers, is that our and actually you see this throughout the debates and the ratification of the Constitution, is that our system of separation of powers is not based on checking and balancing classes. It's based on checking and balancing just different institutions. It's the president, it's one house of the legislature, it's another house of the legislature. But the whole idea is that this is not about classes. And what they say is, why would it ever be about classes? We don't have classes here that we would need to check against each other. And that is something that you see said in these debates. On the broader question about inequality, you know, the idea here isn't that there's perfect equality, certainly. There was not perfect equality at the time of the founding. Far from it. There are big differences. But the differences are not extreme, and are not at the huge extreme levels that you would see either in Europe at the time or really even see today. And I think that's the idea, is that there's got to be a range that is broad. And one thing I'll say about this is how culturally this is important. So you talked a little bit about the need to spur people to act. But the other side of this is what it takes to have a virtuous citizenry. And one of the things that's surprising, I think, to a lot of modern ears when you read the founding generation is how skeptical they were of commerce. And they're very skeptical of commerce because they thought it would destroy virtue. And one of the important things about the middle class is it gives everyone a measure of being similar to each other and a measure of economic independence. And both of those things, they thought, developed the kinds of virtues that were needed for people to be equal citizens in a republic. And so I think that's another way of thinking about the same set of ideas, that this is really a different world where they have different considerations. Things like virtue are at the forefront of their minds.
Good evening, Joel Heller. A lot of the examples you gave for the idea that the time of the founding America was kind of premised on an idea of equality had to do with property ownership. And so do you have any examples aside from that that show this idea of economic equality was kind of built into the system? And also, do you think property ownership still needs to be part of the Constitution or part of the conversation today when talking about restoring a middle class?
So most of the founders talk quite a bit about property. The reason is because property was the primary mode of wealth at the time. And there was a lot of land property available here in America. So property is really core to how people think about this. And you see it throughout the writings of basically every one of the leading founders. Maybe most famous is Jefferson, who says when he gets rid of the entail, which is a way to link property to your descendants over time. If you've watched Downton Abbey, the very first season is all about the entail. This made property law professors just giddy with delight for, I think, years that pop culture knew the entail. But what Jefferson said is that when he tried to get rid of the entail and succeeded, he, quote, laid the axe to the pseudo-aristocracy. Because this was what was going to, property distribution was the key way that an aristocracy would develop over time. So that's a big part of it. But there is a sense that, you know, there were other people in the time of the founding who weren't just, you know, farmers. There was a lot of artisanal labor at the time. And again, the idea there, though, is people are owners of their own work. They are independent, and they act separately. There were some merchants. There was a merchant set of people. But the comparison in what merchants made even between America and Europe was pretty stark. So by one account, the wealthiest merchants in America had wealth levels of about 50,000 British pounds. Compared to in London, where the wealthiest merchants were around 800,000 pounds. So that's a factor of 10 plus in thinking about just the differences among merchants. So I think even in the cases where we're not talking about just farmers and agricultural land, there were stark differences between America and Europe.
Thank you. Thanks for a great presentation, very well organized.
Thank you.
I'm wondering about the role of political populism in relation to inequality, sort of historically, but of course especially in the present context. It seems like populism ought to potentially be a sort of process that society goes through to sort of react to rising inequality. Maybe it doesn't always work that way. I don't know, but historically, can you say that it typically works that way? And given, and if that is true, then given that now we have inequality, rising inequality, we also have rising populism. Does that hold some hope for the future?
Great question. So you do see populism throughout American history, and it comes in waves. It comes often at times of fear of inequality, fear in the changing economy. The Jacksonians are populists at a time when there is big changes in commerce. One scholar calls this period the Market Revolution, the expansion of commerce in the 1820s or so. And Jacksonian populism is in part a reaction to that. In the late 19th century, during the Gilded Age, you have the populists, the party we know as the populists, but a group of people also that we consider populists with a small p, the Knights of Labor, the Farmers Alliance. There's a wide variety of these groups that organize and really try to change the nature of the economy, doing some of the things like I suggested, antitrust, income taxes. But in fact, the populists in that period actually really presaged many, many of the 20th century's goals. They advocated for the 8-hour workday, for banning child labor. They actually used the phrase equal pay for equal work, referring to women getting paid equally. This is way back in the late 19th century. There's populists, and it's not all populists, but there was a strand of populists that tried to unite African-Americans and white working class people in the South even. And they organized them. They pushed hard to try to link across race in order to push back against what they saw as a planter aristocracy that was keeping down both races. That effort failed, obviously. But there was a lot of populism at different times to push back against this. And so one of the things I think is most striking that I found in researching the book is how many times change happened because of real grassroots action. It required leaders also. There were always leaders, Teddy Roosevelt and others. But there was massive mobilization on the ground. And so one example of this is the United States passes a corporate tax in 1895. And this is partly a response to the panic of 1893 and the massive depression that follows. And people get organized. They're angry. There's marching in the streets. There's violence. And this is an element of populism, and it leads to economic change. And I'm not advocating for violence, certainly, but the idea that people who are really engaged can push political actors to be responsive to their needs is an important one, and really drove a lot of the progressive changes, both on the economic side and on the political side.
Hi, my name is Bonnie Naradze, and you spoke about Aristotle talking about the great middle class as it was at that time. As I recall, he wrote about having serious doubts about a democracy, because he said that a democracy leads to tyranny. And so what was important to him was education, and that the educated people be the ones to be in the hierarchy, the ruling hierarchy. the benevolent ruling hierarchy. So you haven't said anything about education. What you've talked about is owning property, kind of inequality of wages and everything. What's the connection with education, since we're mindful of the fact that the current person who sometimes sits in the White House said, I just love uneducated people because they're the ones who vote for me. Your thoughts?
So education. Well, there's multiple ways we can think about education in the context of the system. So the first is we might have a link between education and the middle class, or the education and economics. Now, some people think and define the middle class based on education. And so that gets back to our conversation earlier about how we think about what is the middle class. There's another idea that we have, largely a 20th century idea, but there's an element of it in the 19th century too, that education is the best, maybe even the only way to move forward into the middle class. There's a book by a couple of economists called The Race Between Education and Technology, which suggests that education is the way to stay ahead of technological changes and still be able to be successful in the new economy. So we could think about education on the economic side of the ledger. On the political or constitutional side of the ledger, a number of people throughout our history have believed that education was very important for having a virtuous citizenry, for having citizens who understood their duties, understood their responsibilities in the society. And so education was a key component of that. But they also thought that education was important for uniting us as a people. So many of the founding generation advocated, for example, for a national university. James Madison at one point said he thought this would be good because it would help build social harmony across different kinds of people. So there was an element of bringing people together. In the 19th century, you see the land-grant colleges, which are both an element of economic opportunity, but also are there to help build an educated citizenry throughout the West and throughout the growing expanse of the country. So I think education plays a role in many of these different dimensions and is an important one. I'll just add one other thing about how education can be experiential and help lead to virtue. In the Gilded Age period, the populists, many of them thought that the answer to the problems of their period, which was basically the creation of the corporation, that's what they saw as one of the big innovations, where there were now owners, shareholders, and then wage workers, was not socialism. It wasn't national ownership. It was creating cooperatives. And the idea of the cooperative was that the workers would both be owners and workers, but they would also share in governing the cooperative, in governing the corporation, and that would train them in the process of making hard choices, learning how the institution ran, and these would be the kind of virtues that are good for the education of a middle-class person. But also of a citizen who has to deliberate on national questions where there are trade-offs and where there are real challenges as well. So there's different kinds of ways to think about education in that context.
We're just going to take these last two questions.
Oh, thank you for coming here. I'm foreign as well. So I was a bit disappointed for you not bringing up Scandinavia with their... They really established something in their equality. High taxation, welfare system, that's the how we could impose such a thing when the only thing Americans think about is reducing taxes. I think that's a very important point. Welfare. Welfare. I believe that a lot of Americans think welfare systems is useless thing, and you did not mention welfare, so I just want you to comment on this.
So when we talk about inequality, there's a few different things we can and should talk about. One is the difference between the let's split up. We have three categories. We could talk about the poor, we could talk about the middle, and we could talk about the rich. There was a period of time in our history where the biggest divides, the biggest problems were between the poor and the middle. And actually, in the period of the Great Compression, the period after World War II, late 50s, early 60s, there was a lot of poverty in America, desperate poverty in America. And there was a big divide between the poor and the middle, even though we were relatively equal as a society. A lot of policy things helped solve those problems. As I mentioned in the talk, Medicare, Medicaid, Head Start, many of the welfare programs of the Great Society were hugely important in alleviating poverty. These programs largely succeeded at doing so. Another problem we could talk about in inequality is the difference between the very rich and everyone else. And that's actually more where today there is a problem, is that we see a greater and greater share, the economists tell us, of wealth going to the wealthiest people in our society. And then that is the thing that leads to the possibilities of oligarchy, aristocracy, and so on that we've been talking about. So I think there's an important component to play at the lowest end. But at the moment, I think some of the biggest threats to our republic come from the threat of oligarchy more than anything else.
Thank you very much for coming. My name's Sterling. I'm looking forward to reading your book. What do you think is the impact of technology on wealth inequality? Since there's a microphone, I can't help myself. You know, March Madness is going on. You've got a few of these basketball players that'll go on to the pros, and they'll make an incredible amount of money. The difference between, use an example of George Washington, and now, as I see it, one of the main differences is sort of technology. So my question is the impact of technology on wealth inequality.
Mm-hmm. So I think there's a lot of things that impact inequality, and as I started, I'm not an economist, so I won't pretend to choose which ones are the most important or rank them or anything like that. But technology is got to be part of the story here, and the reason why is we become more productive through technology, but when that happens, people lose jobs. And the question is, can people go back and get retrained or reskilled or get other jobs? A great example of this that we're all probably aware of that looms large in our future is in most states, one of, if not the number one job is driving, driving trucks especially. We now have self-driving cars. In a few years, we may have self-driving trucks. We may have them everywhere. And that'll be a lot of people who lose their livelihoods potentially over a technological innovation that has great promise in a variety of other arenas. For example, fewer accidents potentially, more productivity for people being able to drive all night long. Machine can drive all night long, doesn't need to sleep, doesn't need to take breaks. But so there's a challenge of how we deal in a world of increasing technology with the fact that some people are going to be very deeply disproportionately impacted by this, and I think we see that all over America, that it's very, very hard to figure out how you can retrain or reskill for the new jobs of the future. But that's one of our big challenges. And I think that's a core part of what people today, when I talked about the wisest patriots, need to be thinking about, is how are we going to confront these challenges of the future head on and try to solve them. With that.